Good morning. There you go. You got one. Good morning. How are you guys? Good. Stand up. You're already standing. My brain is not here ever anymore. Would you guys come in from the lobby if you're coming in? We're going to sing a song called Do It Again to start off believing firmly that God isn't done. He isn't just sitting back on the cloud somewhere waiting for us to get things right. He's active and moving in our lives today. So let's sing this.
Thank you. never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop. Lift your voice, church, sing it out. Just like the song says, even when we don't feel it, even when we don't see it, because let's be honest, 2020, it's a little bit hard to see that, right? But he works all things for the good of those that love him, guys. He's so good. He's so good. And it is a blessing to me to hear you guys lift up praise and to hear your voices. So we're just going to sing that chorus together, okay? Oh.
You are way maker.
Singing about our living hope because he is alive and well.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name to the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, 'cause Jesus Christ, my living.
Thank you.
God, I pray that you would join us together. Knit our hearts together with yours, Lord. Not just as individuals, Lord, but collectively. As one body, as one mind, as one heart. For together we are so much stronger. And as your word says, a cord of three strands cannot be broken. So when we join this way horizontally and join this way vertically with you, God, there's nothing that can stop us or you, Lord. I pray that you would bless this service, Lord, bless this time, bless each and every one of us in this room, and empower us with your Holy Spirit to go out, to be your light, to be your witness, to do that in love, in boldness, and in humility, Lord, knowing that you have gone before us and prepared the way. Pray that you would speak through Jen, Lord, directly to our hearts and to our spirit and to our soul. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you, guys. Before you grab a seat, if you would, why don't you turn, say hello to somebody near you, let them know you see them, you're glad they're here. You guys can go ahead and grab a seat then. You know, I got the opportunity to have lunch with a friend of mine, Danny. We had lunch this week, and I came out of that just recognizing how much my heart longs for community, how much my heart longs to have connection and interaction with, you know, as between services here. I was thinking about 2 weeks ago, I got roped into something out of a desperation for community. Derek and a couple of the other guys said, hey, why don't you come with us to a CrossFit class? It'll be fun, right? And so I said, yeah, I'll do that. I want to go hang out with the guys. It'll be fun. It's an hour-long class. I think I made it through 25, 30 minutes of it. Those of you who know me a little bit know that I do not exercise at all. So that was a indicator for me that that community piece was desperately missing. It got bad enough, guys. I was cooking dinner. My community thing is Fridays. I play golf. So this was Thursday. Friday, I was cooking dinner, and I was like, hang on. I got a tea time for tomorrow morning, and I'm not sure I can put a tea in the ground. So I was standing in my kitchen as I was cooking dinner. Legitimately, that's all I had. I couldn't get to the floor. God was gracious, and I got stretched out a little bit before the morning. But that need for community is something that we all have. We all long for. There's been a lot of new people that have showed up over the last several weeks. We would love an opportunity to connect with you. So as you leave today, in the lobby on the left side, there's a couple tables set up. We've got our prayer and next steps area there. If you're new, if you haven't gotten plugged in yet, if you've got something that you'd want to pray about, we would love an opportunity to chat with you. Jen Smith will be out there. Josh will be out there, the rest of our prayer team. We'd love to meet with you, talk to you, get to know you this morning. We're going to move into our offer. Well, actually, before I do that, we also have Intro to Church of the City coming. So those of you who are wondering what this is all about, we can teach you a lot about the core things, those things that are really special to us, what we exist to do, what Church of the City is all about. 2 weeks from now, August 16th, we're going to start our Church of the City classes. They'll be at 11 o'clock in the room 100, so it's during the service. And it'll give you an opportunity to just learn about us, hear how you might be able to get plugged in. No commitment, just an opportunity for you to see if this is a place you can call home. So we'd love for you to do that. You can do that online or at the Next Steps booth. We can help you there. We're going to move into our offering here. This week I had a really special opportunity to participate in the fifth grade graduation that Kid City and City Students put on. Those of you who have kids at those transition grades, whether it be, you know, kindergarten or fifth grade or eighth grade or seniors, know that this school year created like a little bit of a difficult time when it came to celebrating the end of the year. When was it really, right? And there was a celebration time on Wednesday for the fifth graders, and there was a really special, a special meal together. There's an opportunity for parents to pray over their kids as they enter this new chapter of their life. And Steph was sharing a little bit about what Kid City has done, and there was an actual passing of the baton from Kid City to City Students. And it was a beautiful picture to me of the investment that the Church of the City team in the form of Kids City and City Students is making in my children. I've got a fifth grader, a ninth grader, and a tenth, a sixth grader, a ninth grader, and a tenth grader now. And so appreciative of the investment, the kingdom investment that's being made into my kids and our kids. And I was thinking about that even more so, you know, thinking about Derek's investment in Brendan that goes way back. And I was watching Brendan invest in the City Students' kids. And then these new sixth graders come in on Wednesday night. And I got to watch one of the 10th graders that Brendan's been investing in reach out to invest in my sixth grader. And it was a beautiful picture to me of the eternal investment that we can make in one another. And as we talk about giving of our tithes and offerings, this too is an eternal investment in the kingdom work that's going on right here. Matthew chapter 6 says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." We've got a unique opportunity as we give to be able to create places for eternal investment in our community, for the kingdom of God to break through in the lives of our kids, in the lives of the church internally here and externally through different missional partners, investment things. We get the opportunity to do the stories that are rolling in right now of the needs that God's meeting because of your generosity are special. And we want to celebrate that. Let's pray over this offering. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the provision you've given us, Lord, for the blessings of resources that you've provided us with. God, we pray that as we give back a portion of that which you've blessed us with, Lord, you would use it to further your kingdom here in Spring Hill, in Middle Tennessee. God, that you would create a return on that investment so much bigger than we could have ever imagined. God, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity we have to worship you in this way. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, one of those things that we've gotten an opportunity to participate in and see is Antioch. So Derek and Juan shared a little bit with you last week about Antioch's kind of shift into meeting the needs of the community. And this past weekend, they had an opportunity to do their second food drive. So the first one they were able to serve about 75 families. I was talking to Juan this morning, and as he was getting ready for the food drive on Saturday, throughout the week, multiple times, different organizations or people came to him and say, "Hey, I've got more food for you. Would you like to have it?" So he set up Saturday morning, 8 o'clock, they were ready, and there was a line of cars all the way out the drive. They served countless families, and then there was kind of a lull. And he's like, "Oh, we still have all this stuff here. What are we going to do?" And another wave of cars came through. All in all, on Saturday morning, the ministry center out of Antioch Church was able to serve 150 families with meals and food that they desperately needed. So, yeah, you can give it up for that. And we've got another special opportunity to serve them well right now. If you noticed on the way in, there's some backpacks in the lobby. So we are collecting school supplies to meet the needs of 150 students and 100 teachers. And you can text backpack to 94090. And what that will do is it'll send you the Amazon wish list. So if you want to make it super easy, you can click on that link. You can order anything that you want to send. It'll get sent in. You don't have to touch it. You don't have to shop for it. There's also a list on the screen in the lobby. If you want to take a picture and take the kids shopping at Walmart, you can go pick that stuff up. But we're working towards meeting the needs of 150 kids and 100 teachers to take the pressure off of those families and those teachers to find the resources that they need for this school year. And lastly, we've got a big event coming up next week. It's our Connection Sunday. So those of you who are new here, also, the main way we like to find community and get connected is through our missional communities. And next Sunday will be the opportunity for us to launch into a new season. There'll be four new groups opening up. There's a bunch of learning communities opening up, financial peace learning community, racial reconciliation and education learning community. And you're going to have an opportunity to hear some of those stories, the people that are involved in those, and decide, is this a good fit for me? Is this a place, God, where I can get connected? One of the beautiful things that's come out of this season are some of the stories related to the missional communities. Chase and Kristen Macri have been in a unique position where they got involved in missional communities for the first time through Zoom meetings when quarantine started. And that became something that they were burdened for because they've got two boys that are immunocompromised. And so for them to meet collectively with other people right now, it's just not a good time or feasible for them. So they've got a deep passion to find a way to create community and connection through Zoom meetings. So one of our groups that we'll be launching next week will be a Zoom group. And they've got a lot of creative ideas to bring some audiovisual things in and more connection to that Zoom meeting. So if that's something that would interest you, that'll be here, as well as the other groups. We would love nothing more than for everybody in this room and online to be connected some way through a missional community. That will be after the 9 and 11 o'clock service. We'll have tables set up outside, so you can check that out for sure. This morning, we've got a special privilege. We get to hear from Jen Smith, our pastor of discipleship. Jen is going to share with us this morning, in continuation of our Red Letter series, Calm in the Midst of Chaos.
Thank you, Pastor Mike. All right, friends. Well, it is such an honor to be entrusted to teach. I resonate so much with what Jess said, that thinking about this morning and thinking about gathering as a family and being able to come together with God's word is just such a gift. My prayer as I prepared for this morning was that beyond my study, beyond the preparation, beyond my communication skills or even lack thereof, that the Holy Spirit would speak to us, that he would have a word for us this morning. You know, whenever people teach, it isn't that we have mastered the subject of which we teach. It's just that the Lord has brought conviction, that he's been doing a deep work in that area. And over the past 2 years, ever since our Connect for Women group did a study of Jesus through Middle Eastern eyes, this passage that we're going to dig into this morning has been doing its work in me. I've been carrying it. I've been thinking about it. And so it's so much joy for me to share it with you this morning. And we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. And before we get started, let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you that it brings life, Lord, and that every scripture that we read has purpose, that you put it in your word for a reason, to speak truth, to speak hope, and to speak life to us. And so, Lord, today we pull our seat up to the table. We do not come as orphans. We come to our seat for the meal that you have placed before us of your word, God. I pray that we would be hearers of your word this morning and that we would be doers of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, friends, well, we are going to be talking about Jesus calling his disciples from Luke chapter 5, verse 1 through 11. So I'm going to ask you to stand for the reading of God's word. We're starting in verse 1. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of those boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken, and so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Well, as you may have guessed, we're going to be talking about fishing this morning. Do we have any fishermen in the house? A little? Okay, a few. Well, I grew up in Montana. I am not a fisherman, but I did spend many days of my childhood waiting for a fish to bite my dad's line. One of my earliest memories was when I was about 3 years old, and I remember being in a boat with my grandpa and my dad, again, 3 years old, so I really had to go potty. And I'm trying to communicate this to my dad, and he gets out an empty worm can, and he's trying to convince me to use that as a pecan, right? No matter how long I live in the South, I will always have to pronounce that nut pecan for this very reason. Right? We get some of the things that I learned from watching my dad were that it's important to know where to fish, how to fish, what time of day is best to fish. And I remember as kids, we were just mesmerized by that fish finder, counting all of the fish that we could see. But for my dad, that was an essential tool when we were out on the lake so that he could have a good catch. Now, typically, when we read Luke 5, we begin to think how amazing that must have been, that big catch, Peter saying, I'll follow you, I'll leave everything to follow you. But today, I want to go a little bit deeper, below the surface, and I want to look into why is this story so important? Why is it included in Scripture? What can we gain from this? Now, as we begin, I want to clarify, in this scripture, you'll hear Simon Peter. He's sometimes called Simon, sometimes called Peter. You'll refer to me calling him both, but you'll know that it's the same person. So Simon Peter is a fisherman. That's who he is. That's what he knows. And in this story, they've essentially found the jackpot. Andy Crouch a few months ago said, we love easy. And I think that's part of the reason this story is appealing to us. Because in our culture, aren't we constantly, there's books and there's podcasts looking for the magic solution, the financial secrets to easy money. I think that's why Americans spend over $73 billion a year on the lottery for a 1 in 300 million chance of winning. Quoting a well-known movie from my childhood, so you're saying there's a chance, right? If this were a movie or a modern story, the expectation with this kind of catch might be Peter going to Jesus afterwards and saying, hey, Jesus, that was amazing. I've never caught that many fish in my life. Why don't we go into business together? I have a boat. You know where the fish are. We could make a lot of money and never be in want again. But this is not what happens. And to find out why, we need to take a few steps back to the beginning of this story. We've established that Peter is a professional. He knows these waters. He knows when and where to find the fish. And this story, scripture says that it takes place after a long night. Fishermen would usually fish at night, close to the shore where the fresh water feeds into the lake. Now, during the day, fish can see and avoid the nets, but at night, they feed, and that's the best time to catch them. Well, on this particular morning, they've caught nothing. And so I imagine that Peter and his men are feeling discouraged, disappointed, literally empty-handed, maybe a little bit lost. It's a feeling that I think we can resonate with a little bit. At the end of 2019, I'll speak for myself, I thought I was pretty certain about the future. The economy seemed good. I felt relatively safe and secure. I knew where and when to fish. But collectively in 2020, we've experienced several different disruptions in this security, in this safety. And Pastor Matt took us through a list of hard things last week: natural disasters, COVID, racial tension, political tension, mask tension. How and when are our kids going to go back to school? And this big question, how do we navigate who is telling the truth? We thought we knew where the fish were. And now, like Peter, we're feeling disoriented, sad, maybe a little frustrated. And this is when Jesus enters the scene. Kenneth Bailey, in Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes, says it like this. This account does not take place in a synagogue with a hushed crowd listening to an eloquent exposition of a favorite psalm. Instead, the crowd presses around Jesus on a smelly landing with tired fishermen nearby, cleaning their empty nets after a long, fruitless night. Jesus enters the world of the people rather than expecting them to step out of that world and come to him. Jesus entered Peter's world. A couple weeks ago, Pastor Derek taught from Mark chapter 1, verse 15, where Jesus said, "The time has come. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. The kingdom of heaven is near." This story resonates with that Jesus enters Peter's world. Peter is about to have several big kairos moments where time stands still and God is going to give him the gift of hearing from him and choosing to obey. As I look back over my life, I see moments where Jesus entered my world, where the kingdom of heaven came near. When I was 8 years old, a small church in our community sent a van around our neighborhood to invite us to church every Sunday. Now, they would drive through the streets at like 8 a.m. honking their horn for all of the kids to come out and jump in the van. Now, I recognize that could never happen today, right? I was a child of the 80s with latchkey kids and playing outside till it was past dark. But what I remember most about going to that church was feeling loved and seen. This was Jesus stepping into my world. Years later in high school, my cheerleading coach would share Christ with me. In fact, she almost lost her job several times because she shared the gospel. Again, this was Jesus stepping into my world. The summer before I turned 16, my life was beginning to unravel. I was caught in a series of lies by my parents, really living two different lives, the life that I wanted the adults in my life to see and the reality of parties and drinking and wanting desperately to be accepted. And that summer, I read the Gospels, and he came near again, this time with his word. I was at my grandmother's ranch in Wyoming, and it was there by myself that I authentically made that invitation for Christ to come into my heart. Again, God coming near. And since then, throughout my story, he's continued to step into my world. And my question for us this morning is, where has he entered your world? We need to remember these moments when we see God step in, when we see the kingdom of heaven at hand, because he keeps coming near. That's his way. Ask him to show you how he is coming near to you today. Once Jesus enters Peter's world, he begins to offer Peter several invitations. And the first thing that he does is he gets in Peter's boat. Pretty bold, right? And he asks Peter to put out into the water so he can use the boat as a platform to teach the crowd. Now, there's the practical side of this, that the sound would travel easier over water. It will serve as an amplifier for him as he teaches. But more than this, he is offering Peter an invitation to partner with him. At the end of the story, Jesus is going to invite Peter to follow him. But Jesus doesn't begin by convincing Peter to follow him. Instead, he asks for Peter's help. On the screen, you'll see a picture of a boat that was excavated dating from the 1st century BC to the 1st century AD. It was discovered buried in the mud on the shore of the Sea of Galilee after 2 years of drought in 1986. This is a good representation of the boat that Peter most likely had. Now, in a large lake, you could see how a rowboat like this would drift. And so Jesus is essentially asking for Peter to use the oars to steady the boat so that Jesus can teach the people. It seems like a simple enough ask, but Peter is tired. He's had a long, hard night, and he's feeling discouraged. How many times do you and I hear a simple ask from the Lord, and we ignore it? Or maybe we even say no. Maybe we're too busy, maybe we're too tired, or maybe we're simply afraid. I heard a story recently from a friend who was going through a hard time, feeling like there was no one that she could reach out to or talk to. And a friend felt prompted to call her one morning, and she acted on that prompt. And this friend said, she became a lifeline for me in that moment. I felt like not only did she see me, but God saw me, stepping into small invitations. A few weeks ago, I was at Kroger, and we were getting ready to check out, and I saw a woman in line with tears just streaming down her eyes. Part of my favorite part of the story is my daughter saying, Mom, you're going to go check on her, right? And she took the little ones into an aisle, and I went up to the mom, and I said, hey, I noticed that you were crying. Are you okay? And she began to just tell her story of her son, her only son, going to college, being a little afraid of sending him away when things are so uncertain. But it was what she said next that caught my attention. She said, I've been crying in stores for days as I've been preparing everything for him, and you are the first person to ask me if I'm okay. Little invitations. I was able to encourage her and speak life into her. These small moments matter. Last summer, we did an outreach in partnership with Murray County Public Schools to help kids who had food insecurities in the summer. And a friend who is part of our church saw that when the adults would bring the kids would get their meals, but the adults were hungry. And so she began to make lunches for the adults at her home, and when they came to feed the kids, she would feed them what she had made at home. And all of a sudden, it's not just a physical need that's being met, but a whole family feeling loved and seen. Her saying yes to this prompting allowed God to step into that moment for these families. These small invitations, friends, they are important. And they are as important for the people doing them as the people receiving them. Jesus had something in store for Peter, but first, he had a message for the people on the shore, and Peter's obedience was important. Then Jesus is done teaching, and Peter's probably thinking, finally, I can go home. This night can be over. But Jesus tells him, put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch. Now, I want us to put ourselves in Peter's shoes for just a moment. To us, this request doesn't sound strange because we know that he's the Son of God and we know the end of the story. But Peter is a professional fisherman. Jesus is not. Jesus doesn't even own a boat. And yet, here he is giving Peter instructions. What we see looking at this story is God giving Peter another invitation. Are you willing to hear my voice and obey me even when it doesn't make sense? Now, I don't want to read too much into Peter's response, but Kenneth Bailey says that it's a little sassy. He says that when Peter calls him master, teacher, in our culture, it could be more like, yo, boss, or hey, chief. We've worked hard all night, and can't you see? We didn't catch anything. You know, when my four-year-old Cadence hears somebody say something that he doesn't believe, he says, really, dude? Really? Are you kidding me? And that is kind of what I imagine Peter saying, right? I'm tired, and you're telling me how to fish, a rabbi? We've already talked about how absurd this is, right? Going out in the middle of the day, in the middle of the lake, when we fish at night by the shore. And yet, Scripture says, when they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. This catch is amazing. And something significant is going to happen for Peter. But friends, it's not this catch. Peter realizes in this moment that there is something very different about this man. And it's not just that he could do this miracle. What shocks him is that the man who has the power to catch two boatloads of fish isn't interested in the financial gain that this would bring. Peter has dreamed his whole life for a catch like this, and before him is this man who has the power to do it, and yet he chooses to walk away and choose the life of a rabbi, a life of serving people. And Peter finds himself face to face with a man who challenges his priorities at the deepest level. A few weeks ago during host time, Pastor Mike talked about the five capitals, these five areas of life that we tend to prioritize. And the accepted order in our culture tends to be financial, intellectual, physical, relational, and spiritual. Now, I want to touch on these for a minute. This financial capital, when it's at the very top, you've reached the pinnacle when you have the house, the vacations, the car, when you can buy anything that you want. This even influences our faith in a type of consumerism Christianity, which Pastor John Tyson of Church of the City, New York, says, it's like we sign a prenup with God. If you promise to bless me and do this and this for me, I will serve you. If not, it's over. This is about my happiness. And then that intellectual capital, striving for knowledge, for education, for reputation. I am convinced that in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve are tempted with intellect. In Genesis chapter 3, verses 4 and 5, the serpent says to the woman, "You will not certainly die, for God knows when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Intellect is that quest to be all-knowing and always right. And then there's the physical capital. What I look like determines my worth. An obsession with what our bodies look like, endless selfies, these things that go way beyond health. What ends up happening is that these three capitals, financial, intellectual, and physical, become so important that we don't have any time left. Anything that's not a priority usually doesn't get time. And we can even see the breakdown of marriage relationships because of these three capitals. Financial, we have money problems. Intellect, disagreements over who is right and no one wants to give ground. Physical, I'm not attracted to you anymore. When these priorities are skewed, we struggle. And in our culture, and perhaps even in ourselves, we see the exaltation of these three goals on social media. The financial, the posts about our houses, our vacations, our clothes, our cars. The intellectual, this is what I believe. These are my politics. This is my idea and my opinion. And if you don't believe it, then you are wrong. And the physical, the endless selfies and the flaunting. Now, I don't want to shame anyone, but I have been wrestling with this for a long time. And I want to encourage and challenge myself and you to take a look at our priorities. Detective Jeff Alexander came and he talked on the stage about the loneliness and the suicide epidemic in our city. And he talked about going into these huge houses when he's on a crisis call and they're empty. People have invested everything in image in this big house, but inside they're dying. A few weeks ago, I was able to do a site visit to one of our missional partners called the Refuge Center, and they shared with us that middle-aged men are the highest risk group for suicide in Williamson County. And I can't help but think that that has something to do with these capitals. Relational and spiritual depravity in our culture. When spiritual is our last capital, we see this lack of truth-telling, a lack of self-knowledge, a lack of the true position of man. We think that not only should we be allowed to eat of the tree of unforbidden fruit, but we think we're entitled to it, that we deserve it, that we've earned it. And I can only write these things, friends, because I've seen them in my life. I see how my vision can get skewed and how I can get obsessed with any of these. But the kingdom of God is inverted. It's this upside-down kingdom where it's actually the very opposite of our culture and our Western traditions. It's spiritual, relational, physical, intellectual, and financial. And when I talk about spiritual, I'm not just talking about acting spiritual or simply going to church, but being in relationship with God, being known by Him, and having Him know us. John Tyson, again, our Church of the City, New York pastor, says, salvation isn't to help us get to heaven, it's to help us get to God. Relational. God is relational with us. He operates within relationship of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when he talks about abundant life, this is what Pastor Mike was talking about, it's in relationship. Jesus' 3 years of ministry happened in the context of relationship. He thrived there. That's where we will thrive. And physical, wisdom is making good choices for our body. We don't want to neglect exercise, right, Mike? Eating healthy. These things, there are things that we cannot do if our body is failing. We need to take care of it, but it can never become our idol. And then intellectual. Wisdom is good. James 3:17 says, wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Friends, it's not for the building up of self. I want to challenge you that when you're getting ready to post your opinion on Facebook, let's take a measuring stick. Is it peace-loving? Is it pure? Is it considerate? Is it submissive one to another? Is it full of mercy and good fruit? Is it impartial? Is it sincere? And lastly, financial. 1 Timothy 6:10 says, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. What does this mean? It's not money that's evil. It's when our hearts grow afraid to lose it. As our bank account grows, we begin to develop this posture of scarcity. We begin to store it up without doing good, and our world becomes focused around it. And we begin to slowly see ourselves putting our trust in money and wandering from the faith. Peter's response when he is challenged with the life of Jesus is that he falls at Jesus' feet and he says, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." Remember Mark 1:15, the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. This is Peter repenting. This is Peter recognizing where his priorities are off, that he had put his faith and his worth in other things, and he's realigning with Jesus. And rather than calling him chief or boss, he calls him Lord. And this is when Jesus offers his third invitation. Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people. I had a couple people after first service say, "I've never understood exactly what that meant." There's an exchange that's taking place in this verse, a reordering of Simon's life. As a fisherman, Peter would catch fish and they would die, and he would gain from the profit of those fish. But when Jesus uses this word here, that you will fish for people, that you will catch people, it means to catch alive. It means to bring life. What happens next? They pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed him. One of the most powerful examples of this for me has actually been our executive pastor, Mike McCarter. For all accounts and purposes, Mike and his family were doing well, living a good life, coming to church, serving Jesus. And then one day, he and Derek have a conversation about the five capitals. And Pastor Mike realizes, "I think I need to realign. That financial capital has become too important in my life." And he began to let God search his heart, and eventually it led to him resigning from his job. Now, not everyone's story will read like this. I'm certainly not asking any of you to resign from your jobs. But in all our lives, we need to be continually reflecting, assessing, realigning, entering into those kairos moments when Jesus steps in. This morning, as we prepare for communion, you can get your elements ready. I want us to remember that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's close enough to touch. What does that look like in your life? Have you repented and believed? Where is he coming close to you? These elements themselves show us where he has come near. Where the kingdom of heaven came to earth as a baby, needing to be cared for and raised, but eventually becoming a man who would give his life. This morning, as we take these elements, we remember heaven coming near, and we remember that ultimate sacrifice of Jesus' death on the cross. In Luke chapter 22, Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat together. Now in the same way, after supper, he took the cup saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood which is poured out for you." Let's drink together. Friends, when he comes close, he's always a gentleman. We have a choice of how we will respond. And the first and most important invitation he gives is for us to surrender our hearts to him. That initial choice and recognition of him as Lord. I don't know if you have already made that decision this morning, but if you haven't, I would encourage you to think about this, to think about how the kingdom of heaven is coming into your life, how God is stepping in. Have a conversation with the person that you came here with, or come see us at the prayer and next steps table. We would love to have this conversation with you. We would love to pray with you. And for those who have made the important decision to follow him, did you know that he continues to invite you in every single day? There's this progression of invitation that we saw in the scriptures. And this morning I want to ask, where is he extending invitation to you? Is he asking you to come alongside and participate in what he's doing? Because when you do, you will see that he is faithful. When you obey that prompting, when you reach out to pray for someone, when you serve, as you obey, you will continue to see the kingdom of heaven coming near, both to you and to the receiver. Maybe during this season, he's asking you to hear and obey in a way that seems uncertain, or even like Peter, absurd. You don't have all the answers. You don't know what will happen. You simply hear him saying, "Trust me." Peter knew that he would look like a fool to everyone else, but he still put his boat in the middle of the lake, in the middle of the day. Where is God asking you to step out in uncertainty and to know that the only thing that is certain is him? And lastly, where does he want to reorder your life? Friends, this last invitation is hard. It's the invitation to die to self, because reordering your five capitals, it feels like dying. It's a laying down and a stripping away of power and prestige and accolades, everything that this world values. But friends, it's to bring you new life. It's to bring you abundant life that he talks about in his scripture. I see so much in this final invitation, what it means to lead people. What does that look like in your life? To not just do great things for God, but to lead people, to bring life, to catch alive. Certainly, if Peter had only made this large catch, we would have stood amazed. But it was actually his life after this moment that had the most impact on our world. Where can we step into leadership? Where can we lead people? What does it look like for you to disciple? Pastor Derek, when he was preaching about faithfulness and in our Fruit of the Spirit series, said, "Faithfulness is sometimes going when you want to stay, and sometimes staying when you want to go." I have thought about that so much. It would have been easier for Peter to stay on that fishing boat, but he chose to go, follow Jesus. And eventually Peter would watch Jesus choose the way of the cross. He would even choose it himself. No matter how small and insignificant those promptings may be, no matter how great and mighty the invitations are, these choices matter. And friends, I want to thank you for giving the space today for this word. But my prayer in leading up to this is that it wouldn't just be a good Sunday morning. That we wouldn't leave here and say, "Well, that was great. Let's, what are we going to eat for lunch?" But we would actually ask God, "I've heard your word. How can I obey it? What's my kairos moment right now, Lord? Where are you asking me to step out and obey?" I will do the same. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your word, that it's loving and full of grace, that it's hard and full of conviction. Lord, anytime we encounter your word, you're wanting to bring change. You're wanting to bring life change, Lord. No matter how many years that we've known you, Lord, when we dig into your word, you're feeding us and you're saying, "Take this and live it out." And so, God, I pray that you would give us the courage to do so, Lord, that we would have conversations around this, Lord, that we would not just do great things for you, God, but we would catch alive, that we would bring light and love. Jesus, I thank you for this morning together. I thank you for this family. I thank you for what you're doing among us, Lord, and I pray, God, that your word would take root and it would grow to bear fruit in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, friends, thank you for allowing me to teach this morning. I'm going to invite Pastor Mike back up for some ending instructions as well as our benediction. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Jen. Two things for you guys as we go. Those of you online, right after the service, there's going to be about a two-minute break, and then the Kid City FX will start. Those of you here, you're going to have an email in your inbox. Kid City FX is a discipleship tool that we've created here at Church of the City. It's going to give you as parents an opportunity to engage in some spiritual conversations with your kids. So feel free to take a look at that anytime this week. Check that link out. It'd be a great tool for you to use with your children. As you leave, next steps in prayer will be on your left. We'd love for you to stop by and visit with us there. If you would, stand with me. I want to pray a prayer of blessing over you as we leave. I bless you with eyes to see where the kingdom of God is at hand, to see him coming near you. I bless you with a heart of repentance and belief. I bless you with ears to hear the invitations and the courage to say yes. May you know when to go and when to stay. May you always choose his way. Grace and peace. Love you guys.